We are going to a new chapter, and that's non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. That's NSAIDs. None, look at the slide, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. And when you bring these alphabets together, it becomes NSAID. And because there are many drugs, we call them NSAIDs, NSAIDs. They're also called analgesic, antipyretic, and anti-inflammatory drugs. Or they're also sometimes called non-narcotic analgesics. Because when we speak of these drugs, we remember morphine, that's a narcotic analgesic. Let's have a few differences in the form of this table shown on this slide between the narcotics and non-narcotics, especially as far as the analgesia is concerned. The first very important difference is the narcotic analgesics, as the word suggests, narcosis is CNS depression, and that's why you get CNS depression. You don't expect in the usual therapeutic doses to have a great amount of CNS depression or sedation or drowsiness with the non-narcotic analgesics. Narcotics mainly act on the center, that's the central nervous system, that's the thalamus, the center for pain. Non-narcotics mainly act on the peripheral system where you have peripheral pain receptors. Narcotics act on the opioid receptors and non-narcotics act on the peripheral pain receptors. Narcotics produce CNS depression, non-narcotics don't. Narcotics do produce respiratory depression, which is not normally known with non-narcotic analgesics when you use them in therapeutic doses. Narcotic analgesics produce drug dependence. There's a great abuse liability, which is not there with the non-narcotics. Narcotics are usually used for acute types of pain, whereas non-narcotics are usually used for subacute and chronic type of pains. When the pain is shooting and severe and excruciating, narcotic analgesics are extremely useful, whereas non-narcotic analgesics can take care of the dull and mild to moderate pain. Narcotics also relieve the visceral and deep-seated pain, whereas non-narcotics are mainly useful against the integumental pain, pain arising from the integumental structures. And these structures are adjacent to the skin. So skin, bones, joints, tendons, ligaments, bursa, these are called integumental structures. So they mainly are useful against superficial kind of pain. Narcotics include morphine-related drugs, and non-narcotics is the chapter which we are discussing today. That's NSAIDs or NSAIDs. What's the mechanism of action? Look at this slide. Membrane phospholipids get broken down into arachidonic acid by the enzyme phospholipase A2. And this arachidonic acid later can take two pathways. The first pathway is called, look at the slide, I've shown the arrow here. The first pathway is called cyclooxygenase pathway, abbreviated as COX. And this is a cyclooxygenase enzyme. And this is where the NSAIDs act, or the non-narcotic analgesics act. They inhibit this cyclooxygenase enzyme, that's called COX inhibition. And when this enzyme is inhibited, there's decrease in the synthesis of various prostaglandins. I have only shown the step up to synthesis of prostaglandin G2. The other pathway of the arachidonic acid on the other side goes to the lipoxygenase pathway, which leads to secretion of leukotrienes. We just keep this in mind, and when we come to discuss the adverse effects of NSAIDs, this is going to be useful to us. So this diagram is taking you up to PGG2, and I've shown the cyclooxygenase inhibition, that's the site of action of NSAIDs. We go to the next slide. The next diagram will take you ahead of PGG2. Look at this. This is your PGG2. You had come up to this in the last diagram, and from prostaglandin G2, you get synthesis of prostaglandin H2, and this prostaglandin H2 gets converted into various substances. In one of the pathways, prostaglandin H2 can get converted into prostaglandin I2, PGI2, or prostacycline, I'm showing it. And on the other side, it's supposed to synthesize thromboxane A2, TXA2, the substance which is going to produce platelet aggregation and vasoconstriction. So now we are speaking about this particular pathway in the platelets. Prostaglandin H2 getting converted into TXA2, this particular arrow which I'm showing you, is inhibited by aspirin in low doses. So when you use aspirin in low doses, you get this special effect, that as the thromboxane A2 synthesis is reduced. It decreases or inhibits the enzyme thromboxane A2 synthetase, TXA2 synthetase, which is going to synthesize thromboxane A2. So thromboxane A2 comes down and the platelet aggregation is inhibited. This is that novel action of aspirin. In low doses, it inhibits the platelet aggregation, what you call anti-aggregatory effect on the platelets. What is the cyclooxygenase enzyme, and there are how many types? COX-1 is cyclooxygenase 1, is present at many places. and it is supposed to serve the protective function. For example, it works as cytoprotective in the stomach. So as far as COX-1 is present in the stomach, is going to protect the gastric mucosa. The second enzyme, COX-2, that cyclooxygenase 2, is an inducible enzyme and is secreted at the sites of inflammation. So COX-2 is responsible for conversion, getting converted, the various substances getting converted into prostaglandins and then leading to the inflammatory changes. COX-3 is a very novel enzyme. It's present in the brain, and the action of paracetamol, the mechanism of action of paracetamol, one of the thoughts is paracetamol inhibits COX-3, and this is how it decreases fever or decreases the body temperature. So that's about the cyclooxygenase enzyme and its types. We're going to discuss now salicylates or aspirin, and we're going to do the actions of aspirin. We'll keep in mind aspirin is the prototype of the non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. We'll discuss all the actions and adverse effects of aspirin, so we have a general idea what is the profile of these drugs. The first important action is analgesia. That's relief of pain. And the main analgesic effect is due to the peripheral actions. It inhibits the prostaglandin synthesis, as we just saw. It inhibits the synthesis of bradykinin, tumor necrosis factor alpha, and interleukin. Usually it's used in the dose of 300 to 600 mg every 6 to 8 hours. The second action is antipyretic action, and you need the similar dose for antipyretic effect, that's the decreasing the body temperature. It has two components. It crosses the blood-brain barrier, goes to the CNS, hypothalamus is the center for temperature regulation, and the aspirin or the salicylates are going to set the thermostat at a different level, and this is why there's decreasing the body temperature. The second mechanism of action is peripheral, and aspirin or salicylates, they produce cutaneous vasodilation. This cutaneous vasodilation is going to lead to dissipation of heat and is going to produce sweating, and it will lose the heat. This is how the body temperature will be reduced. So there are two mechanisms for antipyretic effect. The third and very important action is anti-inflammatory action. And because prostaglandins are reduced in the same way, various chemical mediators of inflammation are inhibited by the salicylates. They also stabilize the lysosomal membranes, they decrease the mucopolysaccharide synthesis, they inhibit the vasodilation there, and they inhibit the edema. No doubt you need aspirin or salicylates in a bit higher dose, that's 1.2 to 1.5 grams, 3 times a day, to produce the anti-inflammatory action. We go to the next slide to continue the actions. The next action mentioned here is antiplatelet action in low doses. This is how we just now described. If aspirin is given in low doses, it's going to inhibit the thromboxane A2 synthesis, and this is going to produce anti-aggregatory action on the platelets. The next action is on respiration and the acid-base imbalance which it produces. In moderate doses, aspirin or salicylates are known to produce respiratory alkalosis. Whereas you give toxic doses, it's going to lead to increase in the carbon dioxide, leading to respiratory acidosis and leading to metabolic acidosis. So if you look at the final effect of salicylates in larger doses, is going to lead to acidosis. You need to remember this keyword, metabolic and respiratory acidosis. The actions of aspirin also include decreasing the renal and the stomach prostaglandins. That's very important. The cytoprotective prostaglandins in the stomach are going to be inhibited because it inhibits both types of cyclooxygenase enzymes, COX-1 as well as COX-2. So also it decreases the renal prostaglandins. In therapeutic doses, if aspirin is used, it is known to decrease the uric acid excretion. So this is not a good thing. The uric acid is going to accumulate. Its excretion is going to be less. And this is why aspirin is never used in the management of gout. Let's come to the adverse effect by exploring the various actions. The first adverse effect, very important, of NSAIDs in general is on the gastrointestinal tract, that's gastrointestinal intolerance. And this can lead to production of peptic ulcer. This can aggravate the pre-existing peptic ulcers, that the gastric ulcer and the duodenal ulcer, and there can be bleeding from these ulcers. The second very established adverse effect of salicylates is analgesic nephropathy, and that's the renal damage. And this happens due to the inhibition of prostaglandins in the kidneys. This affects the renal blood flow over a long period of time, and this produces renal damage. The third important thing that happens is precipitation of bronchial asthma. Why does this happen? I showed you the two pathways, the prostaglandin pathway, which is coming from the cyclooxygenase enzyme, and on the other side you have the lipoxygenase pathway leading to the synthesis of leukotrienes. When NSAIDs are inhibiting the cyclooxygenase enzyme, the arachidonic acid is taking the other pathway. And that's why you start getting formation of leukotrienes. And I hope you remember, leukotrienes are important chemical mediators of asthma. And this is why salicylates and similar drugs, they lead to precipitation of bronchial asthma. You cannot give these drugs to the patients who are suffering from bronchial asthma. Next thing which is going to happen is respiratory depression and acidosis. And lastly, they can produce hypersensitivity reactions. Aspirin is known to produce acute hypersensitivity reactions, that's immediate hypersensitivity reactions in the form of Stevens-Johnson syndrome. It's also known to produce delayed hypersensitivity reactions like fixed drug eruptions. We come to use of aspirin in children. It was found when aspirin was used in children in higher doses or continuously, it leads to what is called transaminitis, that's increase in the level of the transaminase enzymes. So liver enzyme levels become higher and the liver damage can start, leading to encephalopathy finally, which is called Reye's syndrome. This Reye's syndrome has been found to be more commonly occurring in the children who have been given salicylates for the management of viral infections. So you have to be careful if the child is suffering from viral infection, don't go to give aspirin, it's likely to precipitate Reye's syndrome. The next adverse effect is coming from its antiplatelet action and it can lead to bleeding. There are various other reasons why salicylates can lead to bleeding and there can be occult blood in the stools, which one must keep in mind if salicylates are being given for a long time. The next adverse effect is sodium and water retention leading to edema on long-term use. The next adverse effect is hemolysis in patients who already have glucose-6-phosphate dehydrogenase enzyme deficiency. And lastly, aspirin or salicylates are fetotoxic. They do cross the placental barrier, they go to the fetus and they produce fetopathic effects. The pregnancy risk category during the trimester 1 and 2 is C. Pregnancy risk category is C if aspirin is given during trimester 1 and 2. The pregnancy risk category is risk category D if aspirin is given during the trimester 3. So there are various adverse effects you got to remember for NSAIDs, and please don't forget some important adverse effects like peptic ulcer, bleeding, precipitation of bronchial asthma and analgesic nephropathy. Next, we go to understand what's acute salicylate poisoning. It could be common if someone ingests more tablets of salicylates in a salicylate, especially aspirin. If the intoxication is mild, there's a word for this, it's called salicylism. And in this, you get various symptoms, including vomiting and various symptoms which are associated with the vestibular system and the cochlear system. So it could be vertigo, tinnitus, hearing defects, dizziness, visual disturbances, confusion, finally leading to hyperventilation. And if this patient already had asthma, it would get precipitated. So this is salicylism, and this is mild intoxication. The severe form of acute salicylate poisoning, the patient would be having vomiting, severe bleeding from various sides, dehydration, acidosis, and delirium. What happens here is, aspirin starts uncoupling the oxidative phosphorylation. And when the oxidative phosphorylation is uncoupled, the energy which is there for ATP production is dissipated as heat. The result is the body temperature starts rising. I hope you are with me. Are you listening to me? What I am saying is, aspirin leads to increase in the body temperature. A drug which is used as antipyretic agent. It's very surprising and very interesting. A drug which is used as an antipyretic agent to decrease the body temperature, if it's given in very large doses and if it produces severe form of salicylate poisoning, it uncouples the oxidative phosphorylation and the energy for ATP production is dissipated as heat, and this leads to hyperpyrexia and this elevated body temperature. This patient can get convulsions and then the patient can go into coma. I would like to remind you of another agent which we discussed in the autonomic nervous system. And this agent had severe manifestations, similar manifestations in its poisoning. And the manifestations were hyperpyrexia, convulsions and coma. Are you getting to it? Are you remembering what drug I am talking about? Yes, it was a cholinergic blocking agent. It was atropine. So when it comes to hyperpyrexia and coma, or hyperpyrexia and convulsions and coma, you need got to remember these two poisonings. Number one, atropine overdose, and the second one is this, that's salicylic poisoning. Finally, the patient will get respiratory failure and cardiovascular collapse. So these are the manifestations of acute salicylic poisoning. If you have acute salicylic poisoning, we don't have a specific antidote to manage this. There's no specific antagonist which could remove salicylate. I'm trying to make you remember, if you remember anything we said in the general pharmacology about the management of poisoning. Or otherwise, what you can do is, you can say to yourself in mind that it's a salicylate. When I say citrate, it means citric acid. When I say nitrate, it means nitric acid. So if I say barbiturate or salicylate, it's going to mean barbituric acid or salicylic acid. It means that these drugs are weak acid. Are you getting into it? If a drug is weak acid and you want to remove it from the body, you need to ionize it. And if you want to ionize it more, you need to give an alkali. So we come to the next slide, the management of acute salicylic poisoning. And I've written at the top so that you'll never forget it. The mainstay of treatment is alkalinization. Alkalinization of the blood, alkalinization of the plasma. So that the acidic drug will get more ionized and its absorption will stop and the elimination will be facilitated. To manage acute salicylic poisoning, you need to do the gastric lavage and gastric wash. Then the external cooling, because as I said, there could be hyperpyrexia. You need to give a lot of electrolytes to this patient, and intravenous sodium bicarbonate is going to be a very valuable agent. This intravenous sodium bicarbonate is going to produce alkalinization. You give a lot of fluids and stimulate the diuresis, so you call it forced alkaline diuresis, a similar kind of therapy used for acute barbiturate poisoning. Then you can go for hemodialysis to remove the drug out of the body, and the patient might need blood transfusion, transfusion with platelets, and administration of vitamin K. So that's about the acute salicylic poisoning. Look at this slide. This is an interesting slide telling you take care. What are the situations in which you need to take care with salicylates? Number one, salicylate, if it's given for a long time and if you stop it, then it can amount to bleeding. And this bleeding could be dangerous in patients who are being taken for surgery. So for the purpose of this bleeding, stop aspirin well in advance before surgery, and at least 1 week in advance, preferably, you stop the treatment. Because it's likely that many patients in this world are taking nowadays low-dose aspirin for prevention of myocardial infarction. If this patient is going for surgery, it's going to be dangerous because it's got antiplatelet effect, and due to the antiplatelet effect, there could be bleeding. Excess antiplatelet effect could lead to bleeding. It's better you stop this particular agent at least 1 week in advance. So that's the first take care kind of thing. Next one, avoid in children, if needed as antipyretic, especially those children who are suffering from viral infection. We already discussed this in detail. If the child is suffering from viral infection, with aspirin, the child has got more chances of getting Reye's syndrome. So to avoid it, better don't choose aspirin as the antipyretic agent. Drug of choice in all such situations will be acetaminophen, and that's your paracetamol. The next precaution is, it's good to take this drug with food so that you prevent the gastric hyperacidity, and take a lot of fluids and water. This is going to be helpful. And the patients in whom you should take precaution not to administer this drug is patients with hemophilia, patients with hemophilia, the patients with peptic ulcer, patients suffering from hypertension, heart failure, and renal insufficiency. So also we need to remember about pregnancy and lactation. This drug is not safe in pregnant women and the lactating woman, because this drug has got many other pharmacokinetic characteristics. What are the pharmacokinetic characteristics? Important ones. On the next slide, the title itself is zero order kinetics at higher doses and high PPB, that's high plasma protein binding. When this drug is having highly plasma protein binding property, then there could be displacement of other drugs from the plasma protein binding sites. For example, your patient is receiving NSAID and the patient is also receiving warfarin. Then warfarin is likely to get displaced. Warfarin is an anticoagulant and is likely to produce bleeding. If the patient is receiving anti-epileptic drugs like phenytoin and valproate, these are anti-epileptic drugs, they also have got high plasma protein binding. And if you give an NSAID, it's likely to displace phenytoin and valproate. It will become more free, more in concentration, in pre-concentration in the blood. This is going to lead to their toxicity. So also, the oral anti-diabetic agents are highly plasma protein binding agents. If NSAIDs displace the oral anti-diabetic agent, their level in the blood is going to be raised and is going to produce hypoglycemia. So these are some relevant drug interactions depending on the plasma protein binding. Second important thing is aspirin decreases the uricosuric effect of probenecid and sulfimpyrazone, the drugs used in the management of various diseases. So don't use these drugs, don't use in gout, that's the message. If your patient is receiving probenecid or sulfimpyrazone for any condition, don't give aspirin because aspirin is going to reduce the uricosuric effect. A better precaution to take is don't use aspirin in a patient with gout because as it is, it's not going to be beneficial. The next important interaction is it decreases the excretion of lithium and digoxin, and you know both these drugs are with low therapeutic index and there can be toxicity. It also decreases the effects of antihypertensive agents. So if a patient is suffering from hypertension, is receiving antihypertensive drugs, aspirin is going to decrease the effect of the antihypertensives. Heparin and warfarin, both given together with aspirin, can lead to bleeding. It's not only the pharmacokinetic interaction but the pharmacodynamic interaction, because heparin and warfarin both are anticoagulant drugs. So that's about some very important drug interactions. Alcohol and corticosteroids are known to precipitate peptic ulcer. They are known to produce bleeding, and this is why aspirin is given with these drugs. Again, you have more chances of bleeding. We come to the uses of salicylates. The first use is symptomatic relief of fever, then symptomatic relief of pain, various mild to moderate dull aching pains from joints, tendons, ligaments, bursa, injury, etc. Symptomatic relief of inflammation in various inflammatory conditions like arthritis, osteoarthritis, rheumatoid arthritis, myositis, osteomyelitis, so on and so forth. It is used to prevent or treat niacin toxicity, and one of the important uses of aspirin has been proven is it could prevent the risk of colon or rectal cancer, to prevent the risk of colon cancer or to prevent the risk of rectal cancer. After this, we come to some newer uses, because on this slide you saw aspirin in the strength of 81 milligrams. What is this 81 milligrams? It's a pretty low dose of aspirin. Aspirin is available in low dose in various strengths. That's 75 milligrams, 81 milligrams, 100 milligrams, 150 milligrams, 162 milligrams and 325 milligrams. And as we know, in the newer uses, the novel action is got antiplatelet action in the low doses. And based on this antiplatelet aggregatory activity, we can use aspirin for a number of conditions. Number one is prevention of secondary prevention of myocardial infarction. And nowadays, aspirin is also used for primary prevention of myocardial infarction in the dose of 81 to 162 milligrams every day. That's a low dose of aspirin, and it's going to produce antiplatelet action, and this is going to prevent the myocardial infarction. You can use it for secondary prevention of angina attacks. You can use it for strokes in the dose of 50 to 325 milligrams. You can use it for deep vein thrombosis for its antiplatelet effect. It's also useful in pregnancy-induced hypertension and preeclampsia, which is again based on the thromboxin A2 synthetase and the prostacyclin synthesis. Chewable and soluble aspirin is useful in acute myocardial infarction to restrict the infarct size and to halt the progress of the infarction, which is already happening, in the dose of 162 to 325 milligrams. Once again, be aware, stop aspirin well in advance before the patient is taken for any surgery, at least 1 week in advance.